If you've ever handled high viscosity oil at cold temperatures, you'll know it's very difficult to get it moving when it's cold. This is the C.C.Jensen Mobile Flushing Unit, or MFU. This unit is built off of the robust HDU series and combined with a number of specialized features to make it very effective for dealing with high viscosity oils like you'll find in mining haul truck differentials and final drives. The MFU is on a mobile base with heavy-duty casters and a big heavy handle for moving it around. At the back, we've got a tank. This can hold about a barrel of oil, which makes it easier to always have a volume of oil in the machine to make it ready for servicing. Two heaters to help heating the oil. This lowers the viscosity to make it easier to filter. The heater tubes are located at the back. The heater tubes also have individual drains, so if you're ever changing to a different oil type, you can open these valves and drain the oil out of them to make sure you get all the oil out of the system. The heaters each have two thermostats in each heater, and they're located under the junction box cover on the top. With a Phillips screwdriver, you can undo these screws. And lift the cover off to reveal the thermostats underneath. The cycling thermostat is the one with the dial that's located closest to me, and the high temp cutout thermostat is the one with the raised portion here. When it trips, you'll see a button pop up from the center of that, and to reset it, you just push the button down. That resets the heater and you'll be ready to operate again. That can happen if there's no oil flow going through the heaters and the unit is turned off or started without oil in it, and it can quickly reach that cutout temperature and can sometimes trip the heater. The heaters are set to 60 degrees Celsius, so you don't risk burning the oil, and you can also monitor the temperature on the temperature gauge located on the heater tube piping here. The main system pump is located right here with its own dedicated motor. This motor is actually operated by a variable frequency drive, and that's based on the pressure that it's generating by pushing it through the filters. So if you're starting with very cold oil or extremely high viscosity, the system will automatically slow down the flow of the pump in order to get oil flowing through the filters. And also, as the flow is lower, the heating is also greater. So it will aid in reducing the viscosity to allow it to be filtered. The pump is equipped with a pressure safety valve that, in the event of a blocked filter or a plugged outlet, it will allow the oil to recirculate within the pump, so there's no risk of damage to the system. The maximum flow on the unit is about 850 liters per hour, and the minimum is around 300 liters per hour. The three-way valve on the inlet may be positioned so that you're drawing from the onboard tank. So in case you wanted to dispense oil from the unit to your equipment, you can draw from the tank and dispense to the hose. Or if you want to draw from the hose, such as from your sump or differential, you can switch it, and now you'll be drawing oil in through the valve. Likewise on the outlet, in the vertical position, it'll be discharging the oil to the hose. If you want to discharge the filtered oil into the tank, then switch the valve, and now you'll be sending the oil into the tank. So you can have a variety of flow options. You can draw from a hose, dispense to a hose, from a hose to the tank, from the tank to the hose, or just recirculate the oil in the tank. And that can be really helpful if you are between servicing of vehicles. You can keep the oil warm, because it's going through the heaters, and also filtered because it's going through the filters all that time. So the next time a truck comes in for service, you can connect to it and start inducing a flow with already hot filtered oil, and that really helps get the process moving a lot quicker. The tank is equipped with a level gauge, so this shows you how much oil is in the tank. Of course, you want to avoid overfilling it. The tank also has an additional port that you can use to run oil directly into it, maybe gravity draining from a differential or from another system. And there's also a tank vent, which will allow it to breathe according to the oil level. On the back of the tank, you'll see some hose racks. You can either hang your electrical cord or the hoses for servicing your equipment. On the side of the tank is a cleanout. You can remove the nuts here and take the plate off if you ever need to go in and retrieve a lost tool or clean out the tank. And it's also equipped with a drain right on the bottom if you want to drain the tank completely. If you do overfill the tank, of course you'll need to discharge some oil out to bring that level back down. So what you'll want to do is make sure that your valve is set to discharge to the hose. And we have a high level override button on the control box that lets you push and hold it. Then you can start the unit, discharge the oil so it's down below the level. Once the alarm light goes out, then you can release the button and let it keep operating. The tank is equipped with a high level and a low level safety switch. The high level switch is there so that if you're pulling oil in from an external source and pumping it into the tank, you of course don't want to overfill the tank. The low level switch is there, so if you're drawing from the tank and pushing out of the hose, it's watching to make sure you don't run out of oil. The inlet valve is equipped with a proximity switch that knows the position the handle is in. That's to aid with the logic of the high and the low level switches. This is a pressure safety switch, which is watching for a high pressure condition and will trip out the unit if it goes above that threshold. Below it is the pressure transducer. So this is monitoring the actual pressure and varying the speed of the pump accordingly. The filter canister contains four cartridge filters inside of it. This will lead to a service life of roughly 6 to 12 months based on normal usage in a mining haul truck shop. A lot of mobile shops will use the Appleton-style pin and sleeve plug, and so that's an option on the MFUs to get it equipped with a cord and plug like this. So to power up the unit, you'll find the main disconnect on the front. This is also possible to lock out if you flip out the red latch. So to turn it on, switch it to the on, you'll see the display light up, the alarm light comes on, and one of the features we've added is a smart display, and that's located inside the panel, so it's illuminated, so you need to get close, but you can look in and see, and there's a screen inside that will give you messages, and that's specifically related to error codes such as would light up the alarm. So when I look inside, I know that when the unit first powers up, just to initialize it, you do need to press the reset, and it says that on the panel. It says press reset to initialize, then press start. So when I press the reset button, you see the light goes out, and now the unit is ready to start. So in order to start the unit, you press the green start button. Once you do, it will light up. You'll see the RPM start to come up on the motor, and it also indicates your frequency in the top right corner. So it's going to be going to 60 hertz, and it will also tell you the measured pressure against the filters here in KPA. To stop the unit, press the stop button, and it will stop the motor from turning. In order to use the heaters, once you've got the unit started, you can turn the heat switch to on. Now it's built in with a pressure sensing switch so that only when you start having some back pressure against the filters will it turn the heater on. The reason for that is to avoid overheating the heaters without oil in the tubes, because that can lead to a rapid rise of temperature that can trip the overheat cutout. And so this is built in to avoid that nuisance. Inside the panel, we have the frequency drive. That's for controlling the pump motor speed. We have the main contactor. We have the heater contactor. We have fusing to go along with each of those. We have a bank of relays for the various safety systems. We've got the power transformer and power supply for the low voltage circuit and the smart display. This will show you your error messages. And down below is the main disconnect switch along with the terminal blocks for the various external cabling. So the smart display has some messages built into it, and those correspond to the various alarms that could trip the unit. So for example, if the unit is running and trips on high pressure, you'll see the alarm light will come on and the display will tell you what's happened and how to rectify it. So it says filters or outlet blocked or too cold. Once the problem is rectified, you can press the reset button and the fault will clear. In the event of a heater trip, you'll see a message on the display. So again, tells you what the problem is and also how to rectify it. You'll also notice the display has a timer on it, or a counter of hours, and at the top is the unit run hours, so that's cumulative, and we'll just keep counting up. Whereas the filter hours, you can reset it by pressing button number 4 here, and that will, anytime you do a filter change, you can reset the hours to see how many hours you get on each set of filters. While the unit is operating, you can monitor a few parameters. There's a vacuum gauge on the suction side of the pump, so if you're having a hard time drawing oil, you'll see that change and will alert you to a possible cavitation. You have the pressure gauge measuring the pressure against the filters. This will show you your filter blockage. So we've got the range of operating here. This is normal through the green, and up into the red is where you'll be wanting to change your filters. The unit has an automatic air vent on the top, so anytime you're starting with fresh oil in the system, it will automatically bleed the air out so you don't have to crack any vents to let the air escape from the top of the filter housing. To change filters, of course, you'll want to stop the unit and isolate it from any oil sources. And at the bottom is a drain valve here that you can open to let the oil drain out from around the filters. Once the oil is drained out, you can then take the canister off and change the filters. And you can watch one of our other videos to show you how to do that. It's no different than any other HDU filter system. If you're connecting to your mobile equipment, there's a good chance you've got CAT or Komatsu equipment, and we have host kits that can correspond to those various pieces. Many mines will want to track their mobile equipment, and they do this by taking an oil sample at the start of the service and at the end of the service, and those lab reports are then logged in the system so they can keep track of their trucks. And this unit has a convenient pre-filter sample point, which makes a very consistent and good place to take those samples. We would just suggest to wait about 2 or 3 minutes after operating, after starting the unit on a truck, before you take the samples, so that you can be sure that the oil that's coming into your sample valve is coming out of the truck. If you want to know how to take a proper oil sample using this type of a sample valve, we have another video that we'll link to. I hope this video helped you understand the features of the C.C.Jensen mobile flushing unit, and if you want to find out more about it or see how it could work at your mine, please get a hold of us and we'd love to set up a trial for you or share some information from our many customers across mines in Canada.